Hey guys, today we are taking a look at 5.2's notes, which is all about properties of rational exponents and radicals. So kind of extension of what we talked about yesterday with nth roots and with rational exponents. Now we're looking at properties of how those could interact with each other if we have multiple happening within the same expression. So jumping right in here to box one, we were talking about using properties of exponents. So this should be a review for exponent rules back from, we did this in the first section. So remember, if we have the same base being multiplied together like we do here for number one, same base of negative or positive 7, my exponents, when I multiply those two bases, get added together. So this is going to become 7 to the 1/4 plus 1/2 power, which gives me 7 to the 3/4 power. I guess if we combine or make a common denominator, 1/2 is 2/4. And that means 1/4 plus 2/4 is 3/4. For number two, we have two different bases inside our parenthesis. So I can't combine those together at all using product rule because I have two unique different bases. What I have here instead is power rule because we have an exponent power that's being raised to another power. Here I have to distribute my exponent of 2 into both of those two bases, both 6 and 4. When we do that, we end up with... To do that, remember, we multiply those exponents when we have power rule. If we have an exponent being raised to another exponent power, 2 times 1/2 is 2 over 2, or just positive 1. 4 to the 2/3 power, which we would rewrite as 6. We can write a 1 there if you want to, but I just leave it as 6. So 6 times 4 to the 2/3 power, or if you wanted to rewrite that rational exponent, you could do that as 6 times the 3/4 squared. And that would be our final simplification there. Either of those two would be fine. For number three, we've got, again, same base, positive 5 for both top and bottom. Even though I don't see it, there is a positive 1 here as my exponent on 5. If I don't see an exponent, we know it's positive 1. So this is quotient rule, right? We've got our two bases being divided. So we have to subtract our exponent, top minus bottom. So 1 minus 1/3 is 2/3. And of course, you could leave it like that. I'm okay with that. If you wanted to rewrite it again, the cube root of 5 squared, or the cube root of 5 squared, the cube root of 25 is also fine. Last but not least, for number four, we have 42 to the 1/3 power over 6 to the 1/3 power, and all of that is being squared. So we've got a couple of different ways that we can tack this. What I would do, just personally, I like getting rid of that parenthesis first. So I'm going to go ahead just like I did on number two. I'm going to go ahead and take this exponent of 2 and apply it to both of my two things inside that radical. Inside that parenthesis. So I end up with 42 to the 2/3 power over 6 to the 2/3 power. Now, that is something else that we can do. Notice both my top and my bottom have the exact same exponent. Something that we're allowed to do is actually combine those together into a fraction with the same exponent applied to it. Kind of like what we just did, but backwards. Instead of distributing the two, we're kind of factoring out the 2/3 that's an exponent on both of those. Now that step in the process that I just did, that could have been your first step. You could have started with 42 to the 1/3 power over 6 to the 1/3 power and made it 42 over 6 in parentheses to the 1/3 power, but then that's still being squared. But it's up to you. From here, we should recognize that 42 divided by 6 is just 7. So our final answer should be 7 to the 2/3 power as my final simplification. And of course, you could also write it in rational form if you want to. I'm not going to require that it's in either of the two forms unless it's explicitly stated, which in this case, our instructions were just to simplify, which we did. All right, moving on over here to box 2. These are properties of our radicals. We in Algebra 1, we covered the properties of radicals, focusing specifically on square roots. The properties of radicals still apply when we have nth roots as well, with higher index roots, besides just two. So to simplify, we've got a couple of different tools here. Some basic ones. Our product rule of radicals tells me that as long as I have the same radical, as long as that index is the same, so in this case they're both cube roots, I can, if I have the product of the two radicals, I can combine them together into a single radical, which is 12 times 18 in this case. When I multiply those two together, I get 216, which if I take the cube root of that, I would use your calculator, or maybe you're just big brain and you know that 6 cubed is 216. Any way you slice it, we should get positive 6 for that final simplification for number 5. Another property, kind of extending that, knowing that division is just multiplying by the reciprocal, I can apply that same concept here for number 6. As long as I have the same index with division, I can also combine those into a single fraction. So this can also be written as the fourth root of 80 over 5 inside the radical, which is 16 when you divide it. 80 divided by 5 is 16. The fourth root of 16 is plus or minus 2. If you use your calculator for it, you'll just get positive 2. Just remember, like we talked about back in 5.1's notes, if you take an even root of a positive number, you should be getting plus or minus. Because I could do positive 2 to the fourth power to get 16, and I could do negative 2 to the fourth power, giving me 16 as well. Okay, moving along to box number 3. Now, box number 3, we're working on simplifying radicals in writing them in the simplest form. So simplifying them down as far as possible. So anything that can be taken out of my radical has to be taken out of my radical. Now, in Algebra 1, we did this with square roots. My suggested method, I think what everyone preferred in general, was the method where we took our radical and broke it down into the biggest perfect, in the case of square roots, square, the biggest perfect square that goes into that number. We split it off using that product rule we just did with number 5, because then we could simplify that part that is a perfect square, and that means that we can simplify it down as far as we can. Now, with number 7, and with some of these, we'll be dealing with other perfect things. So rather than a perfect square, in the case of number 7, since we're dealing with a cube root, we need our list of perfect cubes rather than our list of perfect squares. So I've already got a list over here. These are just 2 through 7. There are most common ones in terms of cube roots. You might have some that are bigger than that. Just be prepared for it. But these ones at least are kind of our go-to list to start with for perfect cubes. So what I'm trying to do here again, I'm trying to break down 135 into one of these perfect cubes times something else. And remember, when I do this, I want the biggest perfect cube that goes into 120 or 135, so that I only have to do this process once. So the way that I would do this, if you're still a little fuzzy, all of these numbers above that blue line I just drew are my perfect cubes smaller than 135. So I'll just go through on my calculator and just start doing some divisions to see which one of these is a factor. You'll do 135 divided by 125. It's not the case, it's a fraction or a decimal. 135 divided by 64 is another fraction. It's not until we hit 27 that we finally get a factor. We can break 135 into 27 times, 27 times 5. 27 times 5 is 135. So once we know that, now we can split this up into the cube root of 27 times the cube root of 5, just like I did in number 5, that product rule backwards. If I know two things multiply together to get what's underneath my radical, I can split it off into the product of two radicals. And now we know the cube root of 27 is just 3. My cube root of 5 does not simplify, so that's just my final answer. 3 cube roots of 5. It's a little more complicated because this is one where we have to rationalize. So if you remember rationalizing, just a quick little example here, if we had like 7 over the square root of 3, we can't leave a radical as a denominator. I could try and combine these together for, like, just looking up at number 8. They're both the fifth root, so I could combine them together. But then I have the fifth root of 7/8, which does not make it any easier to simplify. So what I have to do is called rationalization. And just as a reminder, for square root here, if we wanted to rationalize, we have to multiply top and bottom of my fraction by something so that my bottom of the fraction is a perfect square or a perfect whatever, perfect cube, perfect fifth root in the case of number 8. So we have to figure out what we have to multiply by. With rationalizing square roots, it was super easy because all we had to do was just multiply my denominator by the same thing. That would give me 7 square root of 3 over the square root of 9, which is just 3. So 7 square root of 3 over 3. And that was the rationalization of 7 over the square root of 3. Now it gets a little trickier in the one that we're looking at because now we're dealing with a fifth root. So we can't just multiply by the same thing on top and bottom because I don't think that that's going to give us something that is completely simplifiable. What we have to figure out here is what my base number is. So in this case, in my denominator, I've got the fifth root of 8. And I want to try and figure out what's my prime factorization. What do I have? Because I want to try and figure out what's the smallest number that is a perfect fifth power that I can simplify down there. Well, in this case, 8 is 4 times 2, which is 2 times 2. So I could say, this is a 2, oops, I'm going to write this a little bit bigger. I'm going to rewrite this just for a second. The fifth root of 7 over the fifth root of 2 to the third power, 2 cubed, is 8. So what I want to try to figure out, or what I want to try to do, is multiply by something on top and bottom so that my denominator simplifies perfectly. Now, since I'm looking for a fifth root underneath my radical, I want a fifth power. That means those two things are going to cancel each other out, and I'll just be left with 2. So what I have to do, if I'm trying to make this a 2 to the fifth power instead of a 2 to the third power, I need 2 more exponents, right? I need a 2 squared to be multiplied on top and bottom. I need 2 squared. But in order to combine it, I have to make sure that it has the same root. I have to have the same radical in order to combine those two together. So what I end up with, multiplying on top, well, 2 squared I know is 4. So I end up with the fifth root of 28 over the fifth root of 2 to the fifth. Because once I combine those two radicals together in my denominator, my bases are the same, so I can just add up those exponents. And now that I have a fifth root of a fifth power, those two just cancel each other out. My final answer is the fifth root of 28 all over positive 2. Definitely tricky, definitely not the easiest thing. We don't deal with that quite a lot, but something to be aware of. You're just trying to figure out what's the smallest thing that I can multiply top and bottom by to make it a perfect cube, or in this case, a perfect fifth power. Another version of rationalizing, so if we have a denominator that has a radical in it, again, we have to rationalize just like we did over in number 8. The issue with number 9 is that we have a sum in my denominator. It's not just that square root of 3, so I can't just multiply by the square root of 3 on top and bottom. Because even though if I distributed my square root of 3, this term would become the square root of 9, which is 3. This would end up being 5 square root of 3, and then I have to repeat the process over again. So that's not going to work. What I have to do to rationalize a denominator that has a sum in it is multiply by the conjugate. So if you remember last chapter, we talked about those complex conjugates, or those irrational conjugates with having my two solutions. If you remember back, we did, like, if we knew that negative square root of 2 was a solution, positive square root of 2 has also a solution. Or 5 plus 3i was a solution, we knew 5 minus 3i was a solution. Same idea here. I have 5 plus the square root of 3 as my denominator. So the easiest thing, the smallest thing that's going to get rid of that denominator, getting rid of a square root in the denominator, is multiplying by its conjugate. So the conjugate of 5 plus the square root of 3 would be 5 minus the square root of 3. So I'm going to go ahead and just rewrite 1 over 5 plus square root of 3. And I'm going to multiply on top and bottom by 5 minus the square root of 3. 5 minus the square root of 3. Now, the reason this works is because if you notice, if I was going to try and multiply these two together, I could FOIL them, right? First times first, insides, outsides, lasts. You would go through and distribute and all of that good stuff. But because we're big brain people, we're smart people, right? We recognize that 5 and the square root of 3 are the same in both of my two parentheses. One of them is positive. One of them is negative. This is a difference of two squares situation. I can use my difference of two squares shortcut. Difference of two squares. We know that difference of two squares gives me my first term squared minus my second term squared when I simplify this. So 5 squared being 25. The square root of 3 squared is just 3. So when I simplify this, my numerator, 1 times 5 minus the square root of 3, is just 5 minus the square root of 3. My denominator, in this case, is going to be just 22, because that's 25 minus 3. Big brain. Use your tools. All right. Flipping it on over to the back side. It will get a little bit easier and then a little bit more difficult again. So our other operation that we have not really dealt with recently is addition and subtraction, which proves to be difficult when we're dealing with radicals, because the only way we can combine these two things together, if they're radicals, is if we have what we call like radicals. Just like terms, we have to have the exact same base and exponent to add our like terms together, right? We can only collect x squareds with x squareds. The same thing applies to our radicals. We can only combine those two things together if I have the exact same radical, meaning what's underneath the radical has to be the same, and the index has to be the same. If you have that, it does become very easy in these problems, because like for number 10, these are both the fourth root of 10. So if you want to imagine, we know that there's a little pretend 1 here. This is like the same thing as saying 1x plus 7x, because those two things are exactly the same. So and what I end up with is 8 fourth root of 10, because you have 1 plus 7. My 4th root of 10 does not change. You do not double it. It's not multiplying those two together. The 4th root of 10 stays exactly the same. It's just collecting up your like terms. So the only thing that's going to change here is my coefficient. Same thing applies for number 11. For number 11, we have our 8 to the 1/5 power. That is the thing that's in common between the two of them. So all we have to do is add their coefficients up. 2 plus 10 is 12. Times 8 to the 1/5 power. Of course, if you wanted to, you could try and rewrite this as a radical instead, but I have no issues with leaving them in either form. Number 12 is a little bit tricky because the way it's written right now, I have the same index, but my radicand is different. The thing that's underneath that radical is different. So I can't combine them right now, but what I can do is simplify my cube root of 54, and, you know, maybe because it's in the section, we're going to be able to have like terms once we do that. So remember, if we're breaking this down, my cube root of 54, I'm trying to figure out what perfect cube goes into 54. Well, in this case, 27 times 2 is 54. So that means that this problem really is the cube root of 27 times the cube root of 2 minus the cube root of 2. So 3 cube roots of 2 minus 1 cube root of 2. So my final answer here should be 2 cube roots of 2. Because once you get that simplification done, my cube root of 2 is the same in both of them. So I can just, again, focus in on their coefficients. Subtraction still operates the same way. 3 minus 1 is positive 2. All right. So we did some simplification just with numbers. Let's go ahead and throw some variables in here as well, because what's life without a little bit of confusion? for our coefficients versus our variable terms, you just treat them separately. You're going to separate this out, and sometimes it's helpful for some of us to even, you know, physically on paper, separate these into two separate things. So you don't get confused on which one's which. So I can separate these out just as is. My numbers, I still simplify the same way as I just did with that cube root of 54 problem. You're looking for the biggest perfect cube that goes into the number that you're dealing with. Here in this case, it actually is a perfect cube, right? 4 to the third power is 64. So that's just a 4 there. Nothing else to simplify. With my variables, it's a little bit different. I don't like to look at it as the perfect cube method. I'm looking for groups of whatever my index is. So in this case, I'm taking the cube root of y to the sixth power. I'm trying to figure out how many groups of 3 I can make with my variable. So I have 6 y values, which means I have 2 groups of 3. So after I take that out of my radical, I end up with 2 groups of 3. So I had y to the second power, y squared, is my final simplification. Since I made exactly 2 groups of 3 with no leftovers, there's nothing still left underneath my radical. You might have some that doesn't simplify perfectly, in which case if you had any leftovers, like if this was y to the 7th power instead of y to the 6th, your y squared would still come out because you have exactly 2 groups, or sorry, you have 2 groups of 3, but then that one leftover, number y number 7, would still be left underneath that radical. With number 14, sometimes it is useful again to split it off into two separate things, kind of box 2 in reverse. I'm going to rewrite this as the fourth root of x to the fourth over the fourth root of y to the eighth. In this case, I have exactly one group of x's, two groups of y's, right? Because we're looking for now groups of 4. So if I have x to the fourth, that's one group. Y to the eighth, that's 2 groups with no leftovers, so x over y squared. Again, be careful here, I'm taking a root of an even number, so I have my plus or minus as my answer. So plus or minus x over y squared, plus or minus x over y squared. All right, getting on to box number, I think this is 7. Again, continuing to just write in simplest form, we've got variables in here as well as our exponents. I already crossed this out, so I forgot to before I printed this out for you guys or before I uploaded it. So go ahead and make sure you guys cross out 16. It's beyond what I would expect you guys to do. It's very similar to number 8 that we did together, just with variables mixed in. So let's not worry about it. Let's focus in on some other stuff. All right, so for our... for number 15 here, we've got the fifth root. So now we're looking for groups of 5, or perfect fifth powers. My 4, that's just 2 squared. That's not going to simplify at all, unfortunately. It's too small of a number to have some exponent of 5 as giving me 4. So for the rest of these, I'm just trying to figure out how many groups of 5 I can make out of my exponents. So I'm going to go ahead and leave, and just I'm rewriting black here, my square root, or my fifth root symbol. And I know I'm going to still have that 4 underneath. So for my a values, if I have 8 of them, that gives me exactly one group of 5 with 3 still left over. So my one group that was able to come out of the radical is a to the first power on the outside. Because I still have 3 left over that don't have a full group of 5, that's a cubed underneath. For my b's, I have b to the 14th power, which I can make 2 groups of 5 in 14 with 4 still left over. And then for my c to the 5th power, that's exactly one group of 5 with none left over. So c to the 1st on the outside and no c's left over underneath. So if you want to rewrite this so it's nice and clean, a b squared c, 5th root of 4 a cubed b to the 4th. Would be your final answer for number 15. Taking a look at number 17, you've got a couple of different things going on here. We have 2 different numbers that we have to deal with. Our coefficients here, we're going to go ahead and simplify those. I've got an x up top and an x in the denominator. But I'm going to have to make sure I combine those as well with our quotient rule. And then we actually do have a negative exponent that we've got to deal with as well. So the only thing that's not going to change in this situation is my y to the 1/3 power. That's fine. I can just leave it as it is where it is. It's got a positive exponent. There's not y in two different places. So that one will stay consistent. So starting with the numbers, which I'll do in yellow just because I'm doing it in yellow. I have it highlighted there. For my coefficients, I can just follow the operation. So 14 divided by 2 just gives me a 7. So far, so good. For my x values that I did in blue, that is x to the first power over x to the 3 over 4 power. So remember, quotient rule tells me I have to do my top exponent minus my bottom exponent. My y is going to stay the same. We didn't say there's anything that needed to happen with that. And then for my z, I've got z to the negative 6th power. We remember, should remember, that if we have a negative exponent applied, we have to flip that from the top to the bottom or the bottom to the top to get my exponent to be negative, or to get rid of that negative exponent to be positive. So I'm going to have a z to the positive 6th power up top. So simplifying where I need to or where I can, 7 up top, 1 minus 3/4 is 1/4. So x to the 1/4 power, y to the 1/3 power, and z to the 6th. And that's as far as I can simplify that bad boy. Z to the 6th. All right, cruising along. Number 18. For number 18, going back to addition and subtraction, but now with variable terms. 18, very straightforward. I've got the same index. This is just square root since I don't have a number written there in the index. What's underneath the radical, my radicand is the same. So since I have that in this situation, I can just combine those like terms. 5 plus 6 is 11. Square root of y. Boom, boom, boom. Nothing to it. For number 19, we have two variable terms. We're close. Right, we've got a cube root on both of them. We've got numbers and z's, but right now they're not exactly the same on both top or on both of them. So what I would do here is simplify both of them first and then see where we end up. So in this left term, 12 cube root of 2z to the fifth, the only thing I can simplify is the fact that I have a group of 3 that I can pull out there. So that gives me 12z, because I had one group of 3. Underneath my radical, that 2 is still there, and I still have z squared. Right, because I pull out 3 from that group of 5, I still have 2 left over. In this right one, so it's still minus in between here, in this right one, 54 can break down into 27 times 2. We've done this one before. Cube root of 54 broke down into 27 and 2, which is just 3 cube root of 2. So this cube root of 27 is going to become a 3 on the outside. There was already that z that was outside of my radical. And then I have the cube root of this 2 is still left underneath, along with the z squared that was already there. And after we do that, hey, look, we magically have cube root of 2z squareds for both of those. So since I have that, I can just focus on the coefficients. 12z minus 3z is 9z, and then my cube root of 2z squared, which was my thing that was in common. That is the final simplification for number 19. That is the final simplification for this set of notes. Your homework tonight is page 248 and 249, 6 through 66, all of the multiples of 6. So I have them listed there for you in case you are not great with your multiples. Yeah, that's all I have for you. So if you guys have any questions, concerns, thoughts, ideas, hopes, or dreams, as always, make sure you guys are reaching out and letting me know. If not, have a fantastic day. Have a fantastic extended weekend, because I will not see you guys tomorrow. We have an asynchronous day, so both my 4th and my 7th hours, I do not see you guys on the computer. So make sure you guys are being productive and getting stuff done. And have a great weekend. We'll see you Monday.